Whoever sees this and subscribes right now will get a free white guy in 1985. Unfortunately, 1984 was out of stock. What's going on, YouTube? It's Nox Hill, and we're back with our reaction series. So today, man, guess what? We've got an artist that we've not done on the channel for way too long. It is finally time to bring back Bo Burnham. This is none other than 1985. But before we get any further, I want to give a quick shout out to the Patreon guys. Listen, a great way to support the channel directly is by joining the Patreon family. Exclusive reactions, exclusive content on there. Again, you want to support, all links to it will be down below. But anyways, no here for Bo. Step up to the plate. Let's see what you got.
He's a really cool guy. He's got a cool shirt. Got cool shoes. Did I mention the shirt? If you ever got the chance to meet him, you'd know why I want to be him.
Is he talking to me? I mean, I have a cool shirt on. I'm not wearing shoes though. But I love how this song opens up, right? 1985. And immediately it's like we're transported back in time. Like we hop onto a time machine with the way the production is. You know, it's got that synthier vibrations to it, the way that it feels, the way it sounds. Even his voice has been filtered. It's almost like Dr. Roboto. It's just filtered in a different way. So it's like we're feeling that nostalgia of the 80s. I don't even have to play Stranger Things. I can just play this song and Bo Burnham is taking me to places and other worlds. It's magical.
Nice to meet him. You'd know why I want to be him. He walks into a room and everyone respects him. He reads the news and doesn't let that shit affect him. He's really happy.
Let that shit affect him. I just like that little clap track thrown in there. I don't know why I thought about like the Bengals and Walk Like an Egyptian. Am I even in the right decade? I don't know. I mean, this is, I'm sat here talking like, yeah, the nostalgia, this really takes me back to the good old days when I was going goo goo gaga and like eating my own boogers. What a fantastic time. I couldn't even talk.
Know why I want to be him. He walks into a room and everyone respects him. He reads the news and doesn't let that shit affect him. He's really happy. He's thrilled to be alive. His name is Any White Guy in 1985. White Guy, 1985.
Oh, man. This is what I love about Bo, right? Honestly, it's like hopping onto a magical unicorn and just riding into the land of leprechauns. Like, you never know what creative vibe he's going to take. He's a very creative artist, and it's catchy, too. Like, I want to sit here right now, and I want to start singing 1985, but it's also, like, so absurd at the same time. And I think he just walks that balance, and he knows how to have just sort of that scale between like absurdity and like acceptance as talent with his music and what he does. And think about how he sets this up, right? Starts off talking about a shirt and shoes, very just generic. Like he's just spoon feeding us, right? He's not giving us anything. There's nothing essentially special about this dude. Sure, he doesn't let the news affect him. Well, that could be one of millions of people in the world. You know, he wears a cool shirt, one of millions of people in the world. Now he tries to get more specific. Any white guy in 1985, that could still be a lot of people, but he wants to be just like him. He's aspiring to be this way, but when you think about it, you're like, hang on, there's nothing really special that he's described this person as so far. So it's that absurdity that turns heads, because all of a sudden you start digesting the lyrics, you start chewing on them, and you go, hang on, something's not connecting or making sense here. He's obviously trying to make a statement, and he's playing off of his humor and his satire and irony. 1985. Was Bo Burnham born in 1985? That's my first initial thoughts. Hence the connection and the parallels in 1985.
He's got a job and a family. How does he do it? Balance his work with his wife's underwhelming cooking. He's got all the...
He's got a job and a family. How does he do it? Yeah, because nobody in the world has a job and a family. See what he's doing? Yet again, he's taking these different qualifiers that, again, are just so incredibly generalized. But he's like, he's celebrating them. He's like, yeah, that's great shit, bro. That's that. Listen, you get a golf clap for that one. Oh, you deal with your wife's underwhelming cooking? Like, you come home and those meatballs taste awful, but you still say they're good. How do you do it? How do you deal with all of life's problems in 1985? And then the work-life balance. I feel like that could go even deeper because this is Bo, and he's going to take a lot of these things to comment on so certain societal situations. So I take it as we're celebrating the man who goes out, who's working, right? And especially like the 80s sort of machismo, masculine type of culture where the wife should be at home, the wife should be cooking up the food for the kids, giving hubby a back rub when he gets home because he's worked so hard. He's the breadwinner. You see how he's poking holes and poking fun at that in the way it's set up. 1985.
He's got a job and a family. How does he do it? Balance
legend
his work with his wife's underwhelming cooking. He's got all the answers that I want to know. How can I be what I am? But 40 years ago, gee whiz, he got it and he falls.
There it is. How can I be that? I'm aspiring to be that, but 40 years ago. I don't know. I think Bo failed math class because we're not in 2025, but it's all good. It's all good. We'll let that one slide.
How can I be what I am? But 40 years ago, gee whiz, he got it and he falls. I am the thing he is, but he isn't when I walk.
I am the thing he is, but he isn't when I walk. He's saying, like, you know, walking the walk, like he can't put that into action. I'm also a white guy, but I'm a white guy in 2022. And I don't have that rose colored world that he has.
He got it and he falls. I am the thing he is, but he isn't when I want. I guess it's true that some people really gotta fight to survive. And some people are white guys in 1985. White guy, 1985.
I guess it's true that some people have to fight to survive. Not this guy, though. Not this guy that Bo wants to be like, right, there it is. Because, you know, whenever we talk about the past and we talk about a decade and the reason why we love things like Stranger Things, for instance, and other series and reboots sometimes when they don't completely screw it up is that it gives you that feeling of nostalgia, right? It gives you that feeling of being taken to a different place. And a lot of times when you look back on the past, you talk about the past, you know, through sort of a rose-colored lens. Like, you look at the great times and the golden times, and that was the golden age and the golden era, but we kind of brush over some of the uglier, you know, some of the stuff that maybe doesn't paint it in the same light and in the same way. And I can't help but feel there is that sort of sentiment that Bo is reflecting through this and through this lyricism.
White guys in 1985. White guys. Wasn't easy being any white guy in 1985. Some white guys were living through the AIDS crisis. Some white guys were Italian.
What?
And I'm not saying it's hard being a white guy now.
Oh, it was a lot harder if you were Italian and white than if you were a different type of white. You know what I'm saying? Oh, Bo. Yeah, there's so much irony and just dry humor to Bo Burnham and the way that he says stuff. And you the sarcasm is just dripping throughout this, isn't it? Because hang on, no, some people did actually suffer, all right? Not everybody got to experience and enjoy white privilege. Some people were actually suffering, especially if you were Italian. I don't know if he's going like a little bit deeper historically because, you know, like 70s, 80s, 90s in Italy, there's a lot of political strife, there's a lot of terrorist attacks and things, but you know, you didn't experience that if you were an Italian-American over here in this country, but obviously the AIDS crisis and the AIDS epidemic. But, you know, he could also be criticizing that in a sense because it was a horrible response to how we handled AIDS at first and then, you know, how we stereotyped it and generalized it, that AIDS only existed amongst the homosexual population and then there was, you know, less importance, less awareness being spread on it through the time. So I can't help but feel when, like, Bo picks a topic, there's definitely layers and layers to it and more criticism and critique than you would think on the surface.
And I'm not saying it's hard being a white guy now. I've misspoke. I don't mean to lump a group of people in a hive. I think I just met my dad in 1985. My dad.
Bo was born in 1985. The song is about a white guy in 1985, everything he wants to be. You know how, you know, you talk about kids wanting to grow up and be like their father. Well, he's sort of taking that sentiment, but he's totally twisting it and sort of bastardizing it in a sense, because he talks about this white guy. So he makes it so relatable because he doesn't reveal to us until this point, this late in the song, now who this white guy is. It is his dad. So there is that connection to a kid looking at his father and looking at his father's life and thinking what it would have been like to be him. I love the little Scots, but I was trying to catch that lyric because I felt like it was important. Oblivious white man. Oh, my God. Oh, is Scott mad at his son? How are relations between Bo and his dad? Does his dad listen to this and just shake his head like, Jesus, Bo, really? You're just going to chuck me under the bus? General contractor.
If I could be anybody, dead or alive, I would want to be my dad in 1985.
Wow, so that took another turn for me. I do think Bo was born in 1985 because it just puts like a nice bow on top of things, because then his dad gave birth to him then as well, and he's reflecting on that time. But 1985 now, and that sentiment we talked about with nostalgia, looking back affectionately and fondly. And there's a biting criticism that Bo has that really comes to light with that sarcasm, especially there at the end, in terms of that last hook and that last sort of line to carry us out, being an oblivious white man. And I think there's a little bit of truth behind that too, because it's almost like, you know, the saying, ignorance is bliss. Like, sometimes I think in today's world where you always feel like you could be walking on eggshells, where being canceled is just around the corner, where you're exposed to so much more online and through social media and through this world, and it can be overwhelming. Yeah, sometimes the default and the easy path and the easy road could be, let's go back to the ignorant days when we didn't have to deal with this. But the greater societal statement that he's saying there is on white privilege. How does he deal with that now as a white man in today's world, where you can't just brush things under the rug in terms of race identity, in terms of gender identity? There's a lot more that you have to grapple with and deal with. And Bo, and we've talked about themes of him dealing with that and grappling with that in the past, you know, those are not themes that his father had to grapple with and had to deal with during that time. So hence the ignorance is bliss, hence the speaking on white privilege, on being a male back then as well, and male to female, husband to wife, working relationships, right? The stay-at-home wife, the sort of stereotypical, generalized, you know, you have to be at home cooking for your hubby, taking care of him. So, wow, so many layers to a song that's just fun. It's a hit. It's a vibe. It gets your head nodding. It gets you into it. But at the same time, like, while you're laughing, while you're being engaged, all of a sudden, like, you end the song and you walk away from it. And it's like you're here. Like, you're elevated. You're elated. And then the song ends and then you kind of go, because you drop down, because you start to digest it. And I think that's the beauty of sort of like the light and the darkness, the bow. And, you know, a lot of comics are like this, I find. You know, they have very dark minds and dark worlds, and yet they're so incredibly funny and incredibly engaging, much like this song. The song's funny, the song's engaging, but it's also revealing a much darker truth and things that kind of do get swept under the rug. Wow. What do you guys think of that one? 1985, Bo Burnham. Comment down below. Anyways, Bo, you were Knoxville certified. So hope you guys enjoyed today's video. If you did, listen, do me a huge favor. Subscribe, notifications on. It really does go a long way. Also, if you want to see more Bo on this channel, comment down below any requests. I try to read all of your comments, guys. I respond as much as I can. So please keep commenting and keep posting. Listen, stay safe, stay positive. It's Knoxville. I love you. I'll catch you again.